to Lake City Live. I'm Kratika. Our guest for today earned the national bestseller tag just within the few months of his first book, A Thing Beyond Forever. It's none other than Novoneel Chakraborty. Welcome to the show, Novoneel.
Thank you so much.
I'm a big fan of your books, and I've recently read The Stranger Trilogy, which is now also available in Hindi.
Right.
So tell us something about the book.
Okay, so I've been telling so much about the book, so it becomes a little this thing, but it basically the book deals with this girl who comes from, you know, she's a 22-year-old girl who comes from Calcutta to Bombay in search of a job because she just passed out of college, and when the moment she lands in Mumbai, so there's this note that she gets which says, be ready, you know, and there's supposedly a man following her and asking her to do things and why and all. So essentially the core concept of the book was, in today's times when youngsters, I felt, were a little disillusioned with, you know, materialistic things, which is a part of it is okay, but then they dived too much into it. I thought I can, you know, say something to those youngsters in the garb of an interesting thriller. And thus the birth of the Stranger Trilogy, The Stranger and Rivana Banerjee, and not in my wildest dreams also, I thought that it will catch up with the youngsters. I wanted it to catch up because that's why you write a story, so that a lot of people read it and relate to it and love it. But even till today, I still think it's a dream because I had written this series with a lot of angst. I tell you why angst, because right before the story, I had written a romance which was kind of rejected by my publisher. So, you know, and my zodiac is a scorpion. I'm a true blue scorpion. So I'm very revengeful, you know, kind of. So I wanted to prove a point that, all right, I mean, you have rejected one story, but I'll give you a story that you will not be able to refuse. So I had written that Stranger series with a lot of angst and a lot of high emotions. And somehow I think that got translated into the story, and people liked it because of one of the reasons why people like to feel that. Yes.
As we know that the lead in this book is a female, Rivana mm-hmm. Banerjee. Mm-hmm. What is the most difficult aspect of writing about a character of opposite sex?
You know, more so because when a guy writes from a point of view of a woman, it's a little more difficult than a woman writing from a guy's point of view, simply because I think women are complex. They are more complex than men. And especially when you write about a 22-year-old girl, she undergoes a lot of emotional, not only crisis, but situations where she herself cannot, you know, analyze it or dissect it. So you as an author, you get down inside her head and try to break it down for her. So it is difficult in a way, but then what happened was, fortunately or unfortunately, this was not my first book. You know, I think I would have more difficulty had it been my first book. So this was my fourth book. Marry Me Stranger was my fourth book. So by that time, and I had written three books before, where I had dealt with women, I dealt with young girls and all. So for me, this book per se was not a challenge that way, because I was experienced, three books old, to write from a point of view of a girl. But to crack Rivana's character was a little tough, because I wanted her to be relatable to today's girl who is, let's say, 18 to 25. And I also wanted to, you know, push the envelope through Rivana a little bit. You know, things that a girl will think twice to do, I wanted Rivana to do that. You know, there was a scene in Rivana where the ex comes back and they get intimate. A lot of girls had questioned me, this was not the supposed right thing to do and whatever. But the thing is, at that moment, a character is just a person. I'm the author of the you know, character, but somewhere I have to be true to what the character, you know, how it reacts. That reaction has to be very genuine. Otherwise, it may just, you know, kind of look and read fake. So answering your question, it is difficult. It is not easy to every time. You know, the most difficult part I feel is book after book to churn out girl characters, new, you know, so that people, my loyal readers who read it and they realize that, you know, it should read a little different. The girl should not, like, for example, my latest book, Forever is a Lie, is a character of 18-year-old girl, Prisha. So Prisha should not read like Rivana. You know, that's more challenge to me rather than getting into a psyche of a girl, because that I think comes a little naturally, maybe with my experience with the kind of women I've been involved with, maybe that also helps.
Is there any particular scene in this book that you found exceptionally hard to write?
Exceptionally hard to write, I don't know, but the prologue was a prologue was something which a lot of people were like, what the hell is this? You know, what the hell is this book? Because the prologue was bold. The prologue was something which I don't think people were ready for, simply because I don't want to reveal the prologue because let people read it, and it's sometimes embarrassing to discuss.
I've read it and it's amazing.
So what happened in the prologue was that something was happening to the girl and she was enjoying it. So I think people had a problem with she enjoying something which was forced onto her, you know. But I personally enjoyed it. But that prologue was, I think, set the tone for the entire series. You know, bringing the stranger in the first prologue with Rivana and all. So that was one scene. I won't say it was difficult for me to write, but something I got a lot of feedback. People had opinions about it, which is anyway most welcome to, because you write books, you create things to get opinions from people. People should not be indifferent towards your work, because the moment they are indifferent towards your work, it means that they don't care about it. Opinion means that they care about it. That's why you can either love or hate, but both are emotions. You know, hatred is also an emotion, love is also an emotion. So I'd rather take all the opinions than having someone who says, I don't care about the book. So that prologue was one thing that was interesting. There are other, you know, a couple of scenes where, you know, every time Rivana used to say, are you there? And a message used to pop up in the phone always, you know. So that was pretty intimidating to a lot of, people who read the book, like, how the hell is he there, you know. So that was an interesting scene. These are the two scenes which were really interesting.
While writing, are you always in control of the story, or your characters at times hijack?
No, I can talk about myself, that I write it because I have somewhere, I don't start a story till the point I have surrendered to the characters. You know, I've surrendered to the story. So the story has to take a grip on you, because it's for an author, it's like you are stalking the characters, you are stalking the story, it's not you are leading it. Though for an audience, it seems like that the author is leading the character, the author is, you know, leading the story, but actually he's just following the character, he's just following the story, and if you follow the character, you will reach the story. So for me, I always try to second guess what the character will do, can do, what the character stands for, and that's where I, you know, discover interesting twists, mini twists in the entire story. This thing, I don't think I can ever lead anyone. I don't think anyone can lead a character that way, because it's a very subconscious thing. You cannot lead a character. A character has to lead you, you know, and then it may come across as if you are leading it, but it's not. It's not.
Talking about characters, if you could cast your book in a Bollywood adaptation, who would play Rivana?
Firstly, I don't want Bollywood to, you know, adapt my book and mess them up. Because the thing is, the kind of my book, so now you have read the Stranger series, I don't think anybody will do justice by, you know, directing it that way, because it's bold. Half of the scenes will be chopped off. And secondly, I don't know, I mean, I've never thought about it. Just because I have a crush on Priyanka Chopra, I thought maybe she would suit the role, but then now she's a little elder, like after doing all those Quantico and so things, she's a tough guy now, like, yeah. So I don't know, I mean, maybe in today's time, Alia Bhatt could suit the age better. Like, she will look like a 22-year-old, you know, who is vulnerable and wanting some stranger in life, maybe that.
An intriguing question, what did you edit out of this book?
What did I edit out? Oh my God, I have to go back in time. A couple of things, but I'm not recalling exactly what, because I've written a few more books after that. But nothing major that would have affected the story, because when you write your first draft, it's always more, and it's always advisable to write more and then cut. It's the rule of editing. Like, you can edit out long things, you cannot add stuff. So I had written a lot, I had edited out things, but nothing really major, you know, because by the time, as I said, it was my fourth or fifth book that I wrote. So I was very, I had come into a control where I used to think out my chapters and then I used to write it. So in my mind, that editing had already happened, you know. And then, because earlier when I started writing, I used to write everything down. I didn't need to mind edit it. But with more books, it came to me naturally that I started mind editing it. So when I now write a chapter, I know exactly where it begins, where it goes, and where it ends. So for that, which means that after the second and third draft, I don't need to chop off everything very, you know, in a major way.
Moving on to your personal life as a writer, who has been the biggest influence on you?
Biggest influence will be, I don't know, I mean, there's so many influences. Because when you go through life, it cannot be one person who has been, you know. My parents have been a great influence. My mother, my sister has been an amazing influence, because I draw all my, you know, strong female characters comes from her, because she's fought a lot in life and personally. So I take a lot of inspiration from that. And there was this two soulmates that I had met, you know, and so I draw inspiration from them also. So I don't think there's one person who can inspire you all the time. It changes, either it changes or you draw inspiration for one story from a person because you have undergone something with the person through that person. So there have been people, and majorly women. So, you know, that's why maybe whenever I write, the woman factor comes in and takes over totally.
There are certain moments in our life that changes forever. What will you call a life-changing moment?
For me, it was actually 2008, 14th April, I met with this life-threatening accident. And we were going to shoot a short film, which was a little away from Calcutta. And while we were coming back, I was sitting in the car behind, and it was a head-on collision with another car, and I was thrown out of the windshield, and I went into the highway. And it was a miraculous escape, because when I so this happened at 4 o'clock in the evening, and when I opened my eyes, it was 10 o'clock at night, and something was there in my eyes, so I couldn't understand what it was. I thought I had reached heaven because everything was white completely, and I was waiting for angels to appear and tell me, boss, your time is over. So I was almost into that zone. Okay, I'm in heaven. You know, but thankfully I survived. There were people, there was a kid who died, and there was a driver whose legs were amputated. So it was a miraculous escape for me, you know, almost like a second innings in life. And this was when I was 21, 20, yeah, 20, 21. And what it did to me was, when you see death from so close, what happens is that it helps you to prioritize your life. You know, the two things that came to me immediately were that whether I meet my family again or not. And the second thing very funnily came to me, what will happen to my stories? You know, here I was dying, but I was thinking about how will I tell my stories? You know, who is going to, you know, is this the end? I mean, I have not even written one single novel. So those two things came to me. And when I came out of the ICU, I realized that probably these are the two most important things for me, you know, my family and this work that I want to do. And by that time, I had taken the decision of dropping out of college. So I was just writing, working on my first novel and all. And I had just, you know, presented my first novel to the publisher. And before the accident, they had rejected the novel, so that we don't want to publish it. So I went into the ICU thinking that neither the novel is getting published. No, I'm alive also. I should have died only, because anyway, the novel was not getting published. The kind you become negative sometimes. And then when I came out of the ICU, I went home and checked the mails, and there was the publisher again coming back to me saying that, okay, we'll publish it. I don't know what made him turn his mind or whatever. So that accident, I feel, was completely life-changing, because it was because somewhere I learned what is important in life and what is not. You know, and when you learn it at a very early age, like 20 and 21, you become matured. You know, and because, and I took inspiration from that maturity to write my characters, who generally are a little matured than compared to other characters of other novels. And so that was definitely a life-changing moment. Like I remember the neurologist coming to the hospital, and he was just hitting me on my legs to check my nerves are all right or not. And I was just trying to tell him that it's paining here, it's paining. Then he just asked me to shut up and say that you are alive. That's more than enough, because people have died. So that was a completely life-changing experience.
Having written 8 popular books, what success means to you?
Success for me means that I'm trying to reach more people. That's all. You know, because if you're not successful, it only means that not many have read your works. Or it may also mean that many have and rejected you. You know, but I think for me, success is how much do I reach out to people? Because as a storyteller, you tell stories so that more and more people can, you know, read it or, you know, come across it. So success for me is, I was never very success driven or fame driven as much as I was that I want to tell stories. You know, I was very story focused. Work is, you know, one of my favorite author, Ayn Rand, said that everything that we do in life comes from our work. You know, it's the kind of work you do will bring you fame, will bring you money, will, you know, bring you good wishes from people and all. If you don't do work, if you don't do anything and sit and, you know, just be idle, nothing will anyway happen. So I think work is the most important thing. Success, failure, see, it's a very subjective term also. You know, for some, becoming famous is success. For some, earning money is success. For me, telling a story the way I want to tell is success. You know, and only I will know whether I have been able to tell the story the way I wanted to tell it. Nobody else will know. You know, so for me, success is that only.
Where do you see yourself 10 years from now?
No, I am very scared of seeing myself in the future. I just, you know, live for the day. Maybe till tomorrow I know what I'm doing. Because, you know, the kind of this industry or the publishing business that we are in, it's very difficult to, you know, because it's a risky. Every time you go back to zero, you know, it's like it's like in cricket, you may go out and make a century, but the next innings, you have to start with zero. You cannot start with 100 from that. You know, I made 100 versus whatever team, now I'll start from 100. No, it cannot happen. You come back to zero. So with every story, even if it becomes popular, with the next story, you again come back to zero. And this time, when you come back to zero, you're not only at zero, you're at zero with a lot of expectation. You know, so at zero with a lot of expectation is a scary place to be in. You know, because at zero with no expectation is amazing, because nobody's expecting anything out of you. So even if you make 5 runs, people will be like, okay, chalo kuch to banaya. But zero with an expectation, oh, he had scored this, or he had given this popular hit, now what is coming, I'm waiting. That is scary. And especially in India, where there's a way, and you know, my books has a target audience from 15 to 40. So it becomes very difficult to balance every story in a way that a girl, 15-year-old girl also relates, finds something in it, and a 40-year-old woman or a man also finds. So the oldest reader that I've signed a book for is 67-year-old. That's like my friend's mother-in-law. And I was like, when she came to the book launch, I was very surprised. And I was like, auntie, what did you get in this book? Like, seriously, but she said she loved it. I don't know, a 67-year-old, I don't see anything for a 67-year-old in my books. But, you know, I don't know what she drew and what she liked, but she said that she loved the book, the series. And that's about it. Like.
So we can't talk about future, so we'll go back in the past.
Yeah, that's better, I guess.
If you could tell your younger self anything, what would that be?
You should have completed education. Like, I dropped out of college, so I would have loved to complete it and then do. But then I was very rebellious at that time. Like, you know, I used to wear my heart on the sleeves, and I didn't used to, you know, I had a fight with the chairman of my college, and very funnily, I asked him to guess my favorite finger, and obviously I cannot show it on camera. And I was very rebellious. I mean, I look a little sorted, but at that time I was very rebellious. And and you know what happens is that confidence comes from two things: one with knowledge and one with ignorance. My confidence was out of ignorance, because at 20 and 21 you think you know everything about this world, but you don't know anything because you've not moved out, you know. And so I would have loved to you know, tell myself that finish your graduation and then show whatever rebellious nature that you have to show. But it was one of those decisions that in life that you just take it, you know. If someone allows me a second chance, I may not be able to take it, because it needs a lot of guts, you know. Honestly, at 20, 21, when you know you're coming from a family which doesn't have a business to go back to, it's a salary thing. My father used to work for Reserve Bank of India. And even going ahead and telling your parents that I'm done with the education takes a lot of guts, you know. So and I had no clue what I would do in life, except for the fact that I want to be a writer, I want to tell stories. So it's a very gutsy thing to do. Now when I think back, it seems foolish also at times, but because it's too risky. It's just too risky to, you know, risk everything and this thing. But then life is one shot. Either you have the shot or you don't have the shot, you know. So I was pretty confident of that let me give it a shot.
Writing as a profession is very unconventional.
Mm.
What are the common traps for a writer?
Common traps is that the first thing that you can become famous overnight. That's not going to happen. Doesn't matter how good you write, how amazing you write. Nobody becomes a overnight sensation in the writing thing. It requires a lot of hard work, a lot of understanding, a lot of loyal readership, a lot of original way of telling stories, a lot of freshness. So that's one trap, because, you know, what happens is that because a lot of young people are coming into this writing thing, what I have also realized, because a lot of people approach me to guide them or, you know, tell them the tips and everything, what I've realized is it's very important to know and have a reality check what you are after. Are you after fame? Are you after really writing? Because we sometimes tell ourselves that we are after writing, we want to be a writer, but somewhere deep inside it's actually fame that is driving us. You know, and sometimes we ourselves don't know it because we are blinded by that, you know. So if that's the case, then you should not come to writing, because there are other way better, you know, sources and places where you will get fame easily, and maybe a lasting fame also, because writing is very difficult. You know, one of the things I'd like to share is I had heard Javed Akhtar in one of the platforms, and he said, see, an actor, every time he acts, he improves himself. A writer, every time he tells a story, finishes himself. So we writers are finishing ourselves one story at a time. You know, it's ending. It's a scary thought. You know, every time, like now I'm 10 story old. So I'm, you know, what will be the 11th story? Whether I'll be reached the 20th story or not. You know, so every time I'm finishing, the bag is getting empty. And I also don't know what's the last one. You know, after that, will I be able to grab another story which is compelling enough for my publisher to believe in it and my readers to enjoy it? So that's a scary thought. You know, so that's one trap, is what you should know exactly what you are after. If you are after fame, don't come here. You know, if you are after money, there are much better sources which will give you money. You know, but if you have this instinct to tell stories, then, you know, come here. And another trap I would say is some people come here too soon. Maybe they should give a little time. They should read a little bit. They should understand life, you know, because not always at 20, a lot of people go through all the experiences. So it's always better to have experiences. And that voice thing is so important, whether you have something original to say or not. You know, just because XYZ is saying some things, I also have a story and I'll also tell, that will not make you stand out in the crowd. You might end up writing a book, it will get published. You might end up two books, it will also get published. But from the third one, you'll realize you've got nothing to say. You know, you're just copying the market trends that's going on. So that becomes, and that will never give you an exclusive, you know, loyal reader base, because loyal readership only is, you know, gifted to someone who has a very distinct personality, a style. You know, I always say if I'm always happy if someone tears open my covers, book covers, and still read my book, they should know I've written it. That means that I have a style. If it reads like anyone else, then I don't have a style. So the style is very important. That's how you win people. Even if I ask you your favorite author, you will come, give me a name who he or she will have a style. You know, it cannot be someone who has aped someone and become something. So these are two major traps that I see in, you know, someone who wants to be a writer, especially the youngsters.
That was very enlightening. Now we have an interesting round for you.
Okay.
It's called the rapid fire. I have a couple of questions with me and you don't get the time to think. So
okay.
You'll have to rapidly
answer. You're asking
answer.
An author not to think.
You'll have to rapidly answer all
That's
my
good.
Questions.
Huh.
Okay. Ready?
Yeah.
One book that made you cry.
Made me cry? I don't cry reading books.
What is your writing kryptonite?
Writing?
Kryptonite. Like your weakness.
Writing like emotional scenes or something.
Okay. Ever consider writing under a pseudonym?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm already writing one, so.
What did you do with your first advance?
I bought my father a phone.
Your favorite underappreciated novel?
How about A Sin Tonight?
If not right, what would you do for work?
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, I have no clue. Maybe I would just complete my MBA and work somewhere. I don't know.
Do you Google yourself?
I've done it, yeah. Just to see if Google is showing the right pictures.
Your favorite childhood book?
Would be Enid Blyton's Famous Five.
If you had a superpower, what would it be?
I would love to influence people so that they remain happy always.
That's a very good thing to say. Choose one: pen, typewriter, or computer.
Typewriter.
Three books that you read more than three times.
That would be The Alchemist, The Fountainhead, and It Rained All Night by a Bengali author.
E-book or printed book?
Printed always.
That was a great round, and thank you for talking to us.
Thank you so much.
Stay
for
tuned and keep
me.
Watching Lake City Live.